Jodi Arias is one of America's most notorious killers. She was convicted of murdering her ex-boyfriend, Travis Alexander, in 2008. The heinous crime is now the subject of a new Discovery Plus documentary with interviews from the psychologist who defended Jodi. We spoke with him, but first, here is a refresher on the case.
Jodi Arias met Travis Alexander at a conference in 2006. They dated long distance on and off for nearly 2 years. In June 2008, Travis is found dead at home, stabbed 27 times and shot in the head. Police found Jodi's DNA in the home and a digital camera with sexually explicit images of the two. When Jodi was questioned,
one of the things that she did was sing and another one was stand on her head.
Thought that perhaps it was her way to get her cheeks flushed. It's kind of a modeling trick, you know, to flush your cheeks before your photograph. She was an odd person.
She gave investigators three different stories. First, she claimed she was out of town. Then she changed her story, saying an intruder broke in. And later, she admitted to killing Travis in self-defense. In 2008, Jodi was indicted by a grand jury for the first-degree murder of Travis Alexander. Her trial began 5 years later and lasted 4 months. 38 witnesses testified, including Jodi, who spent 18 days on the stand.
I don't remember.
She tried to convince the jury she killed Travis in self-defense.
I grabbed the gun. I ran out of the closet. He was chasing me. I turned around and we were in the middle of the bathroom. I pointed it at him with both of my hands. I thought that would stop him.
The prosecution presented mounds of evidence that the murder was premeditated. Dr. Robert Geffner was called in by the defense on the last day of trial as a last-ditch effort to avoid Jodi's conviction.
The whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
He argued Jodi suffered from PTSD and acute stress, causing her to lose control. After 15 hours of deliberation,
we, the jury, find the defendant as to count one, first-degree murder, guilty.
But the jury could not agree on sentencing Jodi to death or life in prison, so a retrial was granted in 2014. A few months later, the jury could not reach a unanimous decision again, so the judge declared it another mistrial and sentenced Jodi to life in prison without parole.
Earlier, Eric and I spoke with a psychologist that you just saw in that story. Take a look. We are here with Dr. Robert Geffner, the clinical psychologist who examined Jodi Arias and testified in her trial. Thank you for coming on DBL. So you were called in on the last day of the trial by the defense. This was a huge case in the news. A majority of people already believe she was guilty, as Jodi herself admitted, and not a victim of PTSD. So what was that pressure like to defend Jodi?
My main role in that last day that you mentioned was really to explain to the jury how the prosecutor's expert, and I use that word loosely, completely screwed up the testing that they gave, misinterpreted her own results, gave outdated, obsolete information, and that her results were more consistent with trauma and PTSD than what she had said.
Yeah, and you know, I did cover this trial for HLN, so I do remember when you came in on that second trial during her sentencing trial. Here's the thing, and I'm gonna push back here. You believe that she suffered from PTSD. Now, you also believe that she was not a liar, right? If I remember correctly, during your testimony, when Jodi lied over and over and over again to the police, number one, about her whereabouts, when people first questioned her about her role in the, I'm gonna call it a triple murder of Travis Alexander. Now, and then she changed her story, even though she went to his house, traveled from California to Arizona, went to his house with her hair dyed to remain undetected, with cans of gasoline in her car. Then she says two individuals came in ninjas, those were her words, and attacked she and Travis Alexander. Only when the evidence was presented to her 2 years later did she finally admit that she is a pathological liar. That's on tape.
So the first thing about the lying is they used a test to say she lied on it, and her results on that test indicated she had not. Her test results given by the prosecutor's expert and the other experts in the case who had worked with her, they were consistent with trauma. That was what I said. They weren't consistent with somebody who was psychopathic or somebody who was borderline, which is what they were arguing. Everything you said is exactly what the prosecutor portrayed and pushed. Her being jealous, her basically planning to go down there undetected, I think is the word you just used. None of that was accurate. It was Travis who invited her down. It was Jodi who actually broke off the relationship. And you have that in her journals and emails and texts. You also have Jodi moving away.
That's her narrative. But go ahead.
No, that's the record. No, back up.
The record's based on her diaries. The records
and the emails and texts, and the emails and texts back and forth between her and Travis.
I could also present other emails, texts back and forth that also speaks to his narrative. But Erica, please chime in.
Well, Dr. Geffner, I did not cover the trial for HLN. Okay. So my curiosity is more about the nature of your relationship with Jodi, because obviously we, the public, don't know her on an interpersonal level, right, but you do. So what was it about Jodi that, one, has you believing her when so many people do not believe her story? And how did you go about coming to your findings in terms of if she was a credible person to support or not?
It wasn't a question of believing Jodi or not believing Jodi. I mean, when we deal with these cases, credibility of a person is always at question, which is why we do a whole variety of different tests and questionnaires to actually look specifically at credibility, at malingering, at all those things. She passed almost all those things. There is no doubt that she lied at the beginning, that she made up stories. Unfortunately, those things did not help her at all.
Dr. Geffner, listen, I'm just really uncomfortable considering I'm always going to be one to stick up for someone that is a victim of abuse. And I really appreciate you taking that role. And I know that you're sticking your neck out and your career out by doing that. But I also think it's important to note to our viewers who are not familiar with this case, yes, you may have interviewed people that felt like that she was a victim of abuse, but then there's also other people that have said that she was 100%, in so many words, psychotic. So I just want to, not discrediting anything that you're saying, and I really appreciate you coming on the phone, on our show and presenting this side, but I also want to make sure that our viewers watching, and also Travis Alexander's family and Travis Alexander's legacy, I mean, he can't defend himself. I think it's important to note when you say those things for me to push back and also let our viewers know that she also did some very questionable things that raised a lot of red flags, not only with Travis Alexander, but his family and his friends.
Wait a minute. You push back, that's fine. I don't have a problem with that, but let me do the same. So one of the things you need to look at is not what the people are saying at the trial. It's what they said prior to the trial. Now, the people you talked about who testified at the trial changed their stories. If you look at their emails and texts from a year before, it was a whole different story.
And Jodi, Jodi changed her stories multiple times.
One of them actually warned Jodi about the manipulation and the problems with Travis.
And later, Travis's friends warned him about the manipulation of Jodi. Considering the heinousness of the crime, considering all these nuanced details, we don't have enough time to cover it all. I wish that we could have you on longer, Dr. Geffner, and I really do appreciate you going back and forth with me. And to hear more from Dr. Geffner, you can watch the brand new 2-hour documentary, If I Can't Have You, The Jodi Arias Story. It's streaming this Friday, February 12th on Discovery Plus. Dr. Geffner, thank you for being here.